tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hello, fight fans. Welcome back to another episode of UFC on AfterBuzz TV. J-Tan here, of course, not Dario Baronato, who I would like to say is in parts on location and parts unknown, but in fact, parts known. But joining me here today, as always, my cohort, my partner in crime, George Hermosa.
Hello.
Hiya, man.
How are you?
I'm all right, dude. Good.
I'm still not over the... I remember you said the perfect 10, perfect tan.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, perfect tan. Like, oh, yeah. I still think that's funny because your last name's Tan.
You still don't think that's funny?
No, I still think that's funny.
Oh, okay. All right.
Because you're like, oh, people call me Perfect Tan, and I thought I was a play on Perfect 10. And if anybody knows me, I love double entendres. I love them.
And if anybody knows George, he's also into Perfect 10.
Yeah.
The subscription?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mail order? Okay.
Yeah.
Duh.
Anyway, guys, cutting back to the chase here. Also joining us in studio here, very honored to have two fighters as a team, and also just two heads on the couch. James Muntasri. I got nailed that one, right?
Yes, sir.
I've been saying it wrong for as long as I've known him, and I just discovered
James.
That. Oh, James.
James.
Right. UFC fighter currently, sorry, middleweight or welterweight?
Lightweight.
That's what I said, lightweight, exactly. And Jessica Pryor, who both these two have fights coming up very shortly here in SoCal. Jessica and James, of course, one of a bit of a growing trend of fight couples, if you will. I suppose it's probably not the first time you've heard that. Jessica having turned pro not too long ago, middle of last year, correct?
Actually, just in January this year.
Oh, was
my first fight.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Yeah. And you've got a match coming up less than a week.
Yes.
Friday,
this
right?
This Friday.
Here at mm-hmm. Commerce. Cool. Well, we'll get to that shortly. First, we're going to run down real fast. Of course, a UFC event happened last night in Berlin, Germany. And good props to George here for pointing out that there's yet another tie-in here to Germany and our guests, which we'll touch base real quickly about that shortly later. First things first, get some business out of the way here. Guys, a message from us to you, us at AfterBuzz, to you guys on iTunes and YouTube, watching and listening to us. Podcast One has, we've teamed up with Podcast One to start an important listener survey to kind of help guide the show, get listener and viewer feedback in terms of what we're doing right, wrong, where you want to see the show go in terms of direction, tone, etc. Takes about 3 minutes, and it's available at podcastone.com. This is your chance to guide us and give us more user feedback. We love the stuff you guys post on iTunes and YouTube comments. We're always checking those, and of course tweets as well. But we have some specific questions here. So go to podcastone.com, fill out the survey, takes 30 seconds, and you will have affected this show. So said all that, let's take a flight over to Germany. The UFC were there for their second time at the O2 World Arena in Berlin. Starting off the show, Taylor Lapidus wins with a TKO in the second round over Yuta Sasaki. Magomed Mustafayev. Now I know how hard it is. I can appreciate what Daria has to go through here. Magomed Mustafayev defeated Peter Hallman after the second round TKO doctor stoppage. Was it second or actually after the first?
Second round.
Was that after the second round? It was
during the second round.
Okay, yeah, at the end of it. Cut to the, I'm sorry, you're right, in the middle of it, 324. A cut over Hallman's eye that the doctor decided was not safe to, that he was not safe to go on. Scott Ascombe wins over Antonio Dos Santos Jr. with a with knees KO of knees in the first round. Noed Lehat over Nicholas Backstrom by majority decision. George, I know I am butchering these names here.
You want me to go? Allen beats Alan O'Mare. Oh, I have an easy one.
Damn,
easy one. Arnold Allen defeated Alan O'Mare with a submission.
Run with it. I feel so badly because we're constantly giving Daria shit about her pronunciations. And I know, guys, I know I nailed these last night. I'm watching the show. I'm listening to Dan Hardy. And granted, British accent. You're going to get screwed up with a British accent anyway. But I know I nailed it. And now I'm fumbling over them. Run with it, man.
Okay. Do you mean like you want me to make fun of you or you want me to just take over?
Or that, I suppose. I didn't think about that. No, let's just get through these here. Mirbek Taisimov, TKO in the second over Alan Patrick Silva Alves. I remember them introducing him as Alan Patrick. That was easy. Makwan Amirkani, Mr. Finland, guy for you guys to watch for. We saw him briefly last year, and I think we're going to continue seeing him. His star rise over Masio Fulan, rear naked choke submission in the first. Nick Hein over Lucas Sajewski, which I know is not right because they had some other pronunciation. Unanimous decision. Peter Sobada, submission with rear naked choke in the first over Steve Kennedy. In the main event, Tatsuya Kawajiri. What's that?
Co-main event.
Excuse me, co-main event. Did I say main?
You did say main.
Over Dennis Seaver, one of the few hometown favorites there, by unanimous decision, which I didn't have a problem with at all. And then in the main event, Joanna Janjacek. Janjacek.
They should nickname her Chinchek.
Joanna Chinchek.
Yeah.
Joanna Chinchek.
You're welcome.
JJ.
You're welcome.
Defending her UFC women's strawweight title against Jessica Penne. She was successful in that and is still undefeated, 10-0. She defeated Jessica with a TKO in the third, just pretty much overwhelming her with shots. Jessica was pretty bloodied up. Good fight. For their efforts, JJ and Penne walked away with Fight of the Night honors. Mm-hmm. The other ones, Mirbek Taisimov and Arnold Allen, winning performance bonuses. Arnold Allen had a fantastic finish. Come in, it was very much come from behind finish. Winning, let me run my notes here. I did not have him winning the, what was that? Was it in the prelims or early
prelims?
Prelims, that's right. He was facing Alan Umar from Kurdistan, and Umar I thought was getting the best of him. I gave him the first two rounds. Umar in the third round, Umar was clinching, got a takedown, and was throwing knees to him. But Allen was able to grab a guillotine choke, and got the tap. Thought it was top position, but not the case.
Cool.
But yeah, good comeback for the young Allen over Allen.
Yeah. Cool. Well, before we start to analyze these fights and get the words from these guys, I want to tell you something about really cool and exciting. What's that, George? You can now apply to Dance Battle America, ABC's new competition special. From our very own AfterBuzz founder, Maria Menounos. You met her? You guys went to the UFC together.
You know, we hang out once in a while.
You and Miss Tough Enough. but yeah, AfterBuzz founder, e-host Maria Menounos, and Julianne Hough, who I love.
Yeah.
She was good at Footloose. Granted, that's the only reason why I watched it. Dancing with the Stars, of course. Comes ABC's Dance Battle America. During the holiday seasons over the last 2 years, Julianne and Maria have engaged in some fearsome battle over social media, which I personally love. I like the creativity.
Beefing.
Challenge took off. Kate Hudson, Amber Riley from Glee, I think she was, joined in. Dance battle craze began. Now everybody's challenging battle, or everybody's trying to battle it out in America, but now you can get a chance to fly out to Los Angeles and actually be on the show.
Really?
Here's an opportunity.
What is the show?
Here is an opportunity of a lifetime. If you want a chance, I can't even talk right now because I'm so excited.
Right?
If you want the chance to dance, you like that, on network television, go to www.dancebattleamericacasting.com for more information on how to submit your video. And remember, you don't have to be a pro like Julianne Hough or myself. Just have fun with it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
It reminds me a lot of the, remember the Harlem Shake from a couple was it a couple of years?
Yeah, this it was at like least a couple years ago.
Yeah. That thing took off virally as well. So I like this idea. It's fun. It's fun when you've got your little online beefs and feuds.
If you follow Maria on Instagram, as you should, she always puts these videos up of the dance mm-hmm. battles like she had last year. She even reposted here and there, and they're just so much fun to watch. I mean, again, submit your videos, dancebattleamericacasting.com. Don't wait. Opportunity of a lifetime.
I wonder how they're going to... What's going to be the design of the show?
Tune in and find out.
Is it people just showing up and dance battle?
Pretty much.
God forbid, what if pro teams start coming in and they just start serving fools? And then in the middle of the thing, it's like...
Yeah?
B-boy stance,
that's
you know?
That's where I come in, but... again, I was told I can't apply. I'm too good.
Mm.
So, yeah.
You should show your stuff then. James got some moves. As we,
they don't call
the moonwalker.
Moonwalker for nothing.
I was gonna say, yeah, we didn't get into the nickname, but the moonwalker. Guys, there's at least a few matches of him online there. At least I saw one on YouTube, and of course, both his UFC matches on UFC Fight Pass, available for $9.99 at UFC.com. Let's see. In one of them, did you at least get to do the Michael Jackson kick?
I think my last one, my last victory, I was able to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My first one, I didn't win, so there's no point in doing it right. If I don't win. But.
But that was a hell of a debut. I mean, I remember that one. Did that one, it was you versus Joe Ellenberger. I was starting to watch it earlier today again. Am I correct in remembering that one got Fight of the Night?
No.
Nope.
Okay. Damn, should have.
Thank
you. Remember that one impressed a lot of people. Twitter was blowing up on you saying, "Who's this James guy?" Oh yeah, RFA. You should have known. any thoughts, George? Talk about the show. What did you think overall?
I always like when they go into European countries because they're such a dedicated fan base.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm always curious on how they're going to react to a lot of the fighters. And as always, you know, the European fan base is always so vocal. And I liked it. I thought it was an overall kind of a short event, if you really think about it. Only four fights on the main card.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it was on Fight Pass, you know, it was a 2-hour, 2-hour show.
Mitch,
similar to like the Fox shows.
Yeah.
But yeah, for the most part, I thought it was pretty good overall. Peter Sabata very much impressed me.
Yeah. What did you, what about the match did you like about it?
Just overall, like his mm-hmm. jiu-jitsu I thought was crazy insane. I think afterwards he said, not he said, but they were quoting him, like Dan Hardy was like, one of his goals is to pretty much fight his idol, who's Damien Maia.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, wow, that's kind of, you know, to try to fight your idol, that'd be pretty cool to see, you know?
But yeah.
Should be interesting on how he goes. I mean, he did pretty good. He's a welterweight, same division. Mm-hmm. I think, did I see Dean Lister in his corner?
Yeah, Dean was in attendance. He was, I guess he was cornering Piotr. Yeah.
Yeah, pretty good. I liked it.
This is a show that, you know, as we talked earlier, there's only about, I think, two actual Germans
mm-hmm.
Of nationality or of, you know, their passport or citizenship.
No, maybe James would know. How far is Poland from Germany?
And I was just born there.
Well, it hasn't changed.
It's, like you're on a
it's
plane.
Still the same distance.
You were on a plane, and then you were born, and it was over Germany, so they had to put something.
They didn't move them there. But that's what Wikipedia is there for, of course.
That's funny.
I was including the Poles and the Austrians in this one to try and figure out, you know, how many, what was Germany's record, you know, as a nation. And I believe I got 4-2. Total, mm-hmm. including the Poles and the Austrians.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one that stuck out to me a lot, I really think we'll continue to see a lot of, Makwan Amirkhani. Actually, I take that back. Makwan Amirkhani and also our girl JJ, mm-hmm. Joanna Yen Jatrek.
Mm-hmm.
Both of them came out with very impressive wins. Amirkhani was able to, shot in for the takedown, got a rear naked choke, finished Maciel Fullen in the first in 141. He impressed me last time too, because this is a guy that's very very gregarious, outgoing. He loves the spotlight, and very emotional reaction for him after this match. he practically said nothing in his post-fight interview. Dan Hardy kept trying to get something out of him. He was almost short of an emotional wreck. Went out into the crowd looking for his mom, or I think, you know, pointed her out. Didn't say anything until he could find his mom and broke down in tears. I think it was really a match dedicated to her and, you know, possibly the first time that she'd seen him fight. Something like that. You could tell it was a special moment for them. But he and Jan Jędrzejczyk, after her win, she was so cavalier and I'm going to say arrogant, you know, but confident as well. I mean, she had the champion swagger and said that there was basically nobody that could beat her, that she was there for a long, long time. This kind of thing, I love this. These two struck me as people that either they realize now what the UFC formula is to kind of stay in the game, to keep yourself relevant and popular. I think they're taking a page from Conor McGregor is what I'm getting at, which certainly not a bad, you know, model to kind of or prototype and model yourself after in terms of marketing yourself. But these two strike me as kind of early stars for the developing European market that I think we may possibly not see fight over here very often, but as the UFC continues to book in Europe, we'll probably see them book them there, you know, quite a bit. You guys caught the main event. Thoughts on Joanna as a champion, as a fighter?
Well, Joanna, she's very, very entertaining to watch.
Yeah.
Like, I think the first fight I saw her fight was the Claudia Gadelha fight.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I was like, who is this woman? And I was an instant fan.
Yeah.
And, I mean, she's so fast, so technical, and her takedown defense is amazing, too.
Right.
With her skills as a stand-up fighter and then her takedown defense, I don't know who's really going to be able to, you know, take her down and beat her.
Right. That was a big part of the Claudia Gadelha match were the takedowns. I actually scored it for Claudia.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought that there was it was close, but I remember I think takedowns were kind of the factor for me in watching that match. Mm-hmm. Surprised that it went the other way, but
it'd be good to have them fight again, I think.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
I think there's a fair argument for that.
I agree.
What did you think of the main, man?
Oh man, I want to hear Gene, because I got a lot to say. I want to get everybody a chance to talk, because I got a lot to say about the main event, but I want to hear everyone else first. James,
man, she has a Joanna. Her style is brutal. You know, her takedown defense is amazing. The elbows and the punishment that she gives for trying to shoot it on takedown on her is awesome. You know, I actually kind of model my game after her a little bit, but you know, I think Jessica Penney. You know, man, you know, credit to her for how tough she was to stay in there. I think she had some good moments. I know she had a judo throw, and I think she had a late, you know, maybe like taking her back moment, but both of them happened at the end of the round. But I mean, holy cow. I thought I was done watching it after the second. I thought that it should have been done after that, but you know, it's
she got opened up, brutal. I believe, in it was the second, right? With the elbow shot to the head. And Penne was, as you said, really was holding her own. I mean, she's
mentally
tough,
very strong.
If nothing else.
Mentally very strong.
And there is obviously other things to her. BJJ black, recently got her black belt, right? Been around for a long time, very impressed a lot of people in Ultimate Fighter when she was on the show. Was it last season?
Season
correct?
20.
20, yeah. Was there anything that you saw? I don't know. I say wholesome. I don't want to get too analytical right away, but you know, because it was such a dominant performance for Jan Jędrzejczyk. But what do you make of this kind of? I feel like it's a new bit of a new generation of the next wave, if you will, of young fighter. I mean, whether it's European fighters or female fighters or whatever. I mean, how do you break her down exactly? You know,
dude, I would be scared to fight her.
Really,
honestly. And you know, like I've trained with Jessica Penne, and her striking is very, very good. So to see, you know, I think, you know, technique wise, they were both very good. But then, like you guys said, that that confidence that the champion has, mm-hmm. and the, like almost like the bravado to carry that and to throw every single strike 100% with no doubt, mm-hmm. is something that I think only experience and big fights you can learn. That I think since doing my first fight to the second fight, dealing with the emotions and the adrenaline is something that, you know, you got to learn. It's those UFC jitters, they're real.
Are they?
And I've competed on big stages, the Pan American Games, Olympic trials, everything. And then mm-hmm. when I did my first UFC fight, it was as if I was a little kid doing my very first martial arts tournament again. But I quickly learned, and now I'm very comfortable.
What is it about those jitters? What are the things that, like, when you walked into the halls, when you got there at fight week, and you have to check in, I believe they probably have you sign posters right away and do various things and stuff. Is it that stuff during fight week, or just gets so overwhelming where you kind of break or don't at fight night? Or is it something else that... I always wonder what people are referring to specifically when they talk about the jitters.
Well, you know, you have to always, before you go for a fight, you have to be there for 5 days. So mm-hmm. you're cooped up in an environment that you're not used to. Because mm-hmm. all athletes, I think, we're creatures of routine. We wake up, we go to our gym, we have our striking or our wrestling days. And just to be thrown out of your routine, and on top of that, you're cutting weight and doing media obligations, mm-hmm. photo shoots, interviews. But just the whole experience in itself, once I arrived for my first UFC fight, I was very pumped up.
Yeah.
You know, in the locker room, I was pumped up. And then, you know, I walked out to my fight, I was pumped up. And then he walked out, and I was still pumped up. And then Bruce Buffer introduced me, I was pumped up. Then he, and so by the time the first round started, I was already tired. I was already tired. So I actually remember in my second fight, as I was walking out, mm-hmm. you know, I was so relaxed. And I just kind of, now I mentally cue myself that, you know, when Bruce Buffer starts to speak, that's when I start to kind of get in the zone.
So you have to pace yourself and peak at the right moment.
Yeah, you know, it's crazy because we train so hard. We do like, you know, 2 to 4 hour sessions a day, but then it's a condensed 15 minutes and you're just like, God, why are these guys getting tired? But it's just dealing with the adrenaline and knowing when to kind of turn up.
Right.
You know, in that environment.
How much warm-up do you go through in the back, typically? Because you see a lot of guys coming out sweating, and you think, dude, did they just, you know, blow their wad back there or what?
Yeah, you know,
proverbially speaking.
I usually warm up a lot just because growing up, you know, both of us have a Taekwondo background. We actually knew each other from Taekwondo, and we fight multiple fights in a day, and oftentimes your first fight is your worst fight. And then as you kind of get in the routine of things, your third, fourth fight, you're just kind of in that zone. So oftentimes I think when I warm up, I almost try to do 3 5-minute rounds and to the point where I'm exhausted. And then I rest for 10 to 15 minutes. And then I go into my fight, which is actually probably I try to train it like my second fight.
Like your second wind.
Yeah, exactly.
You always feel best.
Yeah.
I mean, you never feel your best, especially at the beginning of like of training. You never feel your best at the beginning. Mm-hmm. You feel your best kind of towards like the middle, closer to the end, when you're completely warm, you're flowing.
Right.
You know, that's when you feel your absolute best. And so you try to mimic that when you're warming up.
It's kind of like when getting out of bed. I'm creaking. I'm not moving fast.
That's you all the time. Both of us out of bed.
Shut up. Well, take my word for it. It happens then. That I guess that makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. You gotta. I guess that's why they call it warming up, right?
Exactly.
Get in that zone. Talk a little bit about the matches that you guys have coming up. And Jessica, you're right around the corner, and possibly starting the cut.
Yeah, exactly. Today,
you were saying no to water and popcorn. So,
well, not no to water yet, but definitely no to popcorn right now. Definitely sticking to that chicken and kale diet for the next couple of days. Big fun, but it's okay. I'm feeling really good. Fight's in just a few days. Just have to worry about making the weight. But for me, 125 is not difficult.
Yeah.
So I'll for sure make it. I'm going to feel strong. I'll feel good. I feel great right now. Mm-hmm. So that's always a good sign, feeling good when you're just a few days out. And just got to stay sharp, stay ready, keep the cardio up. And
is it a little bit, as I'm thinking now, of course, you refresh my memory, your amateur record.
It I say three and one.
Yeah. I was wondering how many matches you had.
3-1.
Okay.
Yeah, 3-1.
I fought for me, of course, once at the U of MMA a couple years ago. You were at 125 then as well.
No, I was at 135 then.
Oh, was it 35?
35, yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I didn't want to cut weight for same day weigh-ins. So.
I was going to say, that's what I'm leading to, is the difference you feel in terms of having to make... in terms of same day weigh-ins versus now as a pro, day before weigh-ins?
Quite honestly, I feel pretty much the same physically.
Yeah.
Making the 35 for the same day, that was only maybe 5 pounds off my normal weight, so it's not a big deal. 125, being able to rehydrate and fuel up over that 24 plus hours, I feel great. If you do it right, you won't feel tired.
Right.
You'll feel as though you didn't cut weight.
Right.
And so I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah. Is that a similar experience? You learn just how to get down to that?
Well, I die to get to lightweight.
It's really
very hard. Yeah, it's very hard for me to get to lightweight.
Can we know what you're walking at right now?
Right now, this morning, I was 183. But I walk around at about 200.
Damn.
And then I cut to 155.
Anthony Johnson.
Yeah. Very big. But I usually weigh in at 156, and then always the next day for my fight, I'm about 188.
Wow.
188. Yeah, it's crazy what salt and sodium can do to your
body. Any thoughts on fighting at welterweight at all?
In the future, I would. Actually, my first four fights in the beginning were at welterweight, but I want to give a good run at lightweight just because, you know, when I feel very strong at that weight, and I know that there's not that many people that are bigger than me. And I don't do steroids, so
that's good.
You know, that's
good. Just put that out there. Yeah. Well, it'll be just another summer for you then. Yeah. That's good to know.
But right now I'm just focused on lightweight, but in the future I will eventually move up. Just I want to give a good run at this lightweight thing.
Sure, sure. It makes sense. I've always thought that, the shift, whether you're going up or down, the shift of body weight is, 10 to 15 pounds is a huge thing. And if you're doing that, even though you have to be at that weight only at one point at a certain day, then after that you can be wherever you want. Still, seems like the body needs some time to adjust to something like that in general, to do it healthy, of course.
Yeah.
You're fighting Kevin Lee, 10-1. This is July 15th at the Valley View Casino Center in San Diego. UFC Fight Night. The main event is, George, the main event is...
Is that the Todd Duffy, Frank Mir?
It is Todd Duffy and Frank Mir. Yeah, that's right. A lot of SoCal names on that card. I believe Tony Ferguson is on.
Tony Ferguson. Gilbert Melendez now is on the card. He stepped in to fight Ally Quinta.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Alan Jubon.
Oh, man. Alan Jubon.
Kevin Casey.
Yeah.
Holly Holm. That card is stacked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is, guys, July 15th. Tune in to... Is it Fox Sports or Fox Sports?
It's on a Wednesday.
Okay, so it'd be a Fox Sports one. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, this is going to be one to see.
And that whole week is, July 11th is Jose Aldo.
That's right. Mm.
The next day is a fight night.
Right.
And then,
and then 2 days later is you guys, right?
Exactly.
Because that's, Sunday. Yeah, Saturday, Sunday, and then Wednesday.
Mm-hmm. And then that Saturday, too.
Oh, jeez. We're just busting out the sleeping bags here at AfterBuzz. We're just going to be watching it here. That's going to be a fun one. Thoughts on your opponent?
He's tough, man.
Yeah.
I mean, all the guys are tough guys in the UFC. I feel that, there's really no trash talk amongst, between me and him. But, I think we both respect one another's skill set. And, he's never been finished in his fight. I've never been finished. And I honestly feel like this fight will bring out the best in both of us.
Yeah.
I think our styles kind of complement each other. And, I've had a great training camp. I've been working with Anderson Silva, Lyoto, of course.
I've heard of those guys.
Yeah.
They're good, right?
It's good. They're very good. And then Kevin Casey and Brandon Bender helped me with my jiu-jitsu.
Mm-hmm.
Brian Popejoy for my for my Muay Thai. And then Kenny Johnson for my wrestling.
Nice.
And then I'm working with Jake Ellenberger, who I fought his brother.
Interesting.
Yeah, because Jake Ellenberger is fighting Steve Wonderboy Thompson, who has a karate style. So... for me to go with somebody that good on a daily basis, he's helping me out a lot. So it's, I'll be more than prepared for this fight.
Right. How did that connection come come about?
I think we kind of communicated one another, and even after I got done fighting with his brother, I mean, we were talking, and there's no really bad blood anyways, but you know, I just, his style helps me for my next fight, and my style helps him, so you know.
Interesting.
Exactly. That's just kind
of
how it works.
That makes
out.
A lot of sense. Sure. Jessica, what about your opponent? Now, you're facing somebody a lot more experienced.
Yes. Right? Yeah. Christina Marks. She's very experienced. She's been fighting for a good minute before I even thought that I would be doing MMA. So that's obviously a plus for her. She's strong. She's aggressive. Every time she fights, she brings it. And really, I just got to worry about making sure I'm on my toes, focused, and doing what I need to do.
Has there been a lot of footage for you to find, or is there much out there?
Not too much. No? Not too much. Quite honestly, I just kind of let my coach take care of that aspect of it, and I just really worry about what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. And when I do that, I always feel my best, my most focused.
Will you be cornering Jessica?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes. Yes, I will. Giving him a heart attack, yes.
Now, what company is this for? What promotion?
It's a Bama.
Bama, okay. Mm-hmm. And it's in Commerce?
Yes, yep. Commerce Casino.
Commerce Casino, also home to, former home to Championship Wrestling from Hollywood, among other
back
things.
Back in the day.
Yeah, but it still was.
Yeah.
I'm not wrong, man.
No, that's true. Commerce isn't even that far for all you people that live in Los Angeles. It's literally, if you're in downtown or that general area, was it 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
Yeah, 15.
If that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So people should go check it out.
Talk about you guys both, your background. I'm actually, you know, I was going to start kind of curious to hear how two fighters come together. I suppose that's probably more of a, as I said, a commonplace situation than not, actually. I mean, both people are working out and going, hey, they look pretty good in tights or with the shirt off. But by the same token, you guys knew each other in Taekwondo previously. I don't think I was aware of that.
Yes, we went to this private university in San Bernardino a few years ago, and there was a Taekwondo team, and we were just friends, just trained together. Mm-hmm. And a couple years later, we both kind of made the move to the South Bay and UFC gym. That's where we both worked, and I've just, for some reason, been sticking around him. And it's been, it's going to be 8 years that I've known him now, which is kind of crazy.
Wow.
And it just works. Yeah, it really just works.
What is it about, I mean, I probably know it in my head, but I want to hear it from you guys. It behooves both of you then to, in terms of eating healthy, living a healthy lifestyle, understanding the other one, being under fight pressure, for lack of a better phrase, training pressure. I mean, that's obviously it's such common grounds. Does that play into what's the word, the synergy, or do you guys often find yourselves on completely opposite ends of the spectrum? You both get to peak now, and you know, with these two matches, which has got to be a nice thing.
Right. This is actually kind of the first time we both had a fight so close together, where we're both having to, you know, kind of cut the calories quite a bit.
Right.
Usually one of us is having to cut a lot, and the other one is having to, like, sneak food in the other room. But this time, you know, neither one of us is sneaking.
You think.
Yeah, right. For sure, it does help to understand that, you know, moods can kind of shift a little bit when you're maybe not being able to eat what you want to eat, or when you're training extra hard because you have a match coming up. But really, when there's respect there, it doesn't matter what is going on with either one of us. You know, we both kind of, we have the understanding and support for one another.
I know your intro a little bit into MMA. Correct me if I'm wrong on this or fill in the blanks. Mm-hmm. You were doing personal training at UFC Gym Rosemead?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Correct.
One of your clients, Laura Salazar.
Yes.
Came in and was kind of a reasonably typical situation. Mm-hmm. Hey, I thought I had that off the audio. Came in, wanted to get into good shape, drop a lot of pounds and stuff, and you helped her with that. She went on to fight and kind of sparked it for you, correct?
Something like that. When she, I had the pleasure of being able to work with Laura for like a year. Mm-hmm. and with weight loss and such, and just getting in shape and becoming more, you know, athletic, stable, and being able to move a lot better. And she found Muay Thai after that and just fell in love with it. And she's taken off from there.
Yeah.
And during the time where she came in, we kind of both started jiu-jitsu at the same time, if I remember correctly. And then it was from there that I decided, okay, I think I kind of want to start putting this stand-up and jiu-jitsu stuff together. So, you know, maybe I'll give MMA a shot. And about in 2012 was when I kind of tried it out and been going at it ever since.
Right. Yeah. Now, were you guys a fan of it? Like, who are some of your favorites to watch back in the day or maybe even today?
Anderson Silva and Leon McCain. It still blows my mind that I, before I even started, I was a fan. And now that I see them every day.
Yeah.
Still like a dream come true.
What is it like working with them?
Painful.
Touche. Believe that.
I mean, just for me to spar with them and not really like play spar, but really just take a butt whooping. It's not going to get much worse than that inside of the octagon. And you know, it's I have people who have unique styles to kind of hone my style. And just seeing how they handle the professional side of it, like you said, all the media and all the press and promotion, to see how they handle it is priceless.
Right. Is it, I mean, you talk about obviously going reasonably hard with them. It's not a walk in the park. We're watching them on TV, and especially Anderson in his heyday. It was just magic. Mm-hmm. How did this guy do the things that he does? But you see the mad scientist working on his experiments in the lab all the time. Is there something of that you see that it kind of makes sense that what you see in the on the big screen, or is it night and day or something in between compared with what you see in the gym versus what we see in the cage?
You know, he's just, to both of them, Anderson and Leonardo, they're just the hardest workers that I've ever seen. Particularly Anderson will just spar with everybody. I mean, for his practices are 3 hours, 3.5 hours long. Jeez. And he can just go. And he honestly, I think, you know, he just loves what he does. He's just like a big kid, you know, and he trains all day. He's always training, and he just loves what he does, and he loves to teach as well. So, for me to be around him is amazing, and it's all to my manager Ed Source gave me all these opportunities. So, the least I can do is give him a little bit of my win money.
Ed put together certainly a very good operation between Black House and all the names that are in there. Training there, as well as of course RFA, which you went through. You at least one fight in RFA, right?
Three fights. Yeah.
I was saw him in. Well, I feel like I'm name dropping now. I saw their show a couple of weeks ago in Denver.
Okay.
And ran into him there, and of course, you know, we talked a little bit there about some of the Black House guys coming up, and Tommy Aaron among names.
Tommy Aaron. Yeah, actually, the San Diego fight is three RFA guys, Alan, Joe Bunn, Kevin Casey, and myself. We all did the three RFA shows that were here in Southern California.
Okay.
And so for us to fight in the UFC is kind of for all, you know, all of our dreams coming true.
Right.
And then now, you know, one of the people that is gonna up and coming is Tommy.
Right.
Of course. He trains with me every single day, so he's kind of he gets pushed a lot. But he's going to be a beast. He's actually going to make his pro debut soon. I don't know when, but most likely with the RFA.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm hearing. I'm looking forward to that one as well. Another guy that will have an easy time getting in here. Cool. That'll be an easy booking.
Yeah.
What do you think, George? What's your take on the show coming up, July?
I'm excited. It's a very much so stacked card. Not too far from us, so maybe we can make our way down there and you know
just down the 5, drive. Right?
Yeah. So like I said, I'm excited about that whole card from top to bottom. I know yesterday was kind of like you know, and I was going to go back to yesterday's card about the it's like a double-edged sword. It's like the unfamiliarity of a lot of the guys from yesterday.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, well, I don't know these guys. Let me see what these guys are all about as well, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yes, you had your main event, you know, two very familiar faces, and you had your, well, you know, and then the guys who do impress, well, let me see if they have any additional clips on YouTube or let me find them on Wikipedia. So it's always good to see a very familiar face card and then a very unfamiliar face card. So
yeah,
I kind of like that.
The show definitely delivered in terms of action.
Yeah, I agree. I was going to mention about the main event, going back on Joanna, and I agree with you in terms of her fight with Claudia Gadelha could have gone either way. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of shocked that she got that title shot so quickly mm-hmm. when she impressed me, but
she didn't stand out from the pack.
Yeah, and to the point where I was like, well, it wasn't a very decisive win to warrant that title shot. But man, like the two fights she's had since then.
Yeah.
And I was going to mention, I think yesterday's fight with Joanna and Jessica Penne, it was, I saw the early glimpses of a masterpiece because essentially Joanna was the artist and Penne was the
canvas.
The canvas. And she, let's just say she used a lot of red paint and
that's true.
To paint that picture and just her accuracy. Mm-hmm. And I compare it very much so to Anderson Silva, who was so much accurate. Like when he punches, it means something. Mm-hmm. You know, there's no wasted movement. There's no wasted, you know, attack and strike. Joanna, I could not believe my eyes just how accurate and just how precise she was.
She's landing a lot of flurries.
And not even that. And I know Anderson likes to feel people out for a minute or two. Mm-hmm. But Joanna, like right from the bell, she just kind of gets in there and she just... Like I said, I thought she completely destroyed Penne. Kudos to Penne, like everybody said, the heart. Yeah. But oh my God, like that was an impressive win. And I know Joanna, she said, and I quote, about Ronda Rousey, "I follow Ronda. I'm a big fan of her. She's simply the best. But I want to be the Ronda Rousey in the strawweight division." Girl, I think you're already there. You know, Ronda Rousey, she, of course, she's Ronda.
Yeah.
She will destroy your soul. She'll destroy your body.
Yeah.
And I think Joanna is doing that too in different ways. Mm-hmm. And so I think very much so she is very the Ronda Rousey of the strawweight division. So kudos to her.
Yeah. Do you think, James, we were speaking earlier about I think people are kind of seeing a certain template or prototype to study from in order to market themselves. Do you feel that pressure? Do people talk to you, whether UFC people or... I suppose their marketing team or whatever, in terms of promoting oneself. I feel like I'm using cliche words here, but you know the idea of packaging yourself and putting yourself out there in that way. Is there a pressure to talk that shit, for lack of a better phrase, in that respect? You think that that's is that a trend that's happening now we're seeing or that it's already been there and just taking notice of it now perhaps?
You know, I'm not really one to talk too much trash.
Yeah.
And I don't mind if other people talk trash as long as it's organic, you know, it's not fake or anything like that, but you know, it's part of the business and all my opponents, I never really talk too much trash. I'm sure once I do have somebody that does that, then you know, that time will come, but
you'll just
deal
with
yourself.
It.
If you just be yourself, then you know, Anderson, you know, has millions of fans and he barely, you know, speaks any English, you know. So just let your skills, first and foremost, you're a fighter.
Yeah.
And your skill has to back up what you say.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the most important thing.
Yeah. Jessica, you feel the same way?
I definitely feel the same way. I'm such a shy person. Like I'm not very out there as far as saying something negative about somebody. That just doesn't come naturally for me at all. It would have to be I don't even know if I would fight somebody. Yeah, I would. Mm-hmm. If they were talking a whole lot of mess. No, I'm like, yeah, I would. But for me to actually like respond to whatever mess they're talking about, it would have to be some real messed up things they were saying. It would probably have to be further than just talking about me, because I don't say whatever you want. It doesn't really matter. You know, but for me, I would never start it.
It's kind of the catch-22, isn't it? If you're of being a fighter and talking trash, I mean, if you have it and you like to do it, then your ticket's written, you're good to go. But
I think James said it best, though, where it's a lot better when it comes organically. Yeah. I'm not going to name drop other companies, but I've seen other companies where it's like, dude, this looks so staged. Like, could this be any more, I guess you can say, fake as far as, you know, the trash talking? And then,
right.
Of course, you see the Aldo McGregor kind of build up and like, oh, yeah. See, that's what we want to see. And it's more so, mm-hmm. yes, you're promoting it, but you can tell they're being themselves, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say, it's a catch-22 where you have this aggression inside, but then you go and you fight, you train. You typically get it out of your system. I mean, the little bit, the minimal amount of training that I've done, I'm pretty mellow and I couldn't give a crap about anything afterwards. I'm too damn tired, you know? So to that end, then you're like, yeah, I don't care what they say about me. Go ahead. I got another two-a-day to deal with, you know, afterwards.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so real quickly, let's run down the details again. Jessica, we will see you at Commerce Casino Friday the 25th?
26th.
26th.
Yes.
Friday the 26th.
Yep.
What do you know what time the show starts?
Starts at 7 p.m. Okay. And not televised, but you can get it online on pay-per-view online.
Yeah.
They'll be showing it.
Is it Go Fight Live?
I think so. Bad Beat 15?
Bad Beat 15 or 16, I believe. I think 16. It's 16.
Yeah. Okay.
So gofightlive.com possibly available there. And then
yes.
Do you know, you don't know yet how early or late you are in the card?
You know, I'm not sure completely. Supposedly I'm on the main card, but I don't know if that's after 5 fights, 7 fights, 8 fights. I'm not sure. Find out the day of weigh-ins, probably.
Mocha's ready to get out of here. Mocha's yeah. giving us the sign. Hey, sweetheart. James, you're facing Kevin Lee at UFC Fight Night, Mira versus Duffy. Guys, it's San Diego, Valley
San
View.
Diego.
San Diego. Valley View, Valley View Casino Center, July 15th, the day before J-Day, international holiday. Right, George?
G-Day.
yeah, George and I will be celebrating Black House victories across the board. The day after, or maybe that night early. Mm-hmm. talk to us about social media. Where are you guys at online?
Facebook, Jessica Pryor, and Twitter at Jessica Pryor. And
James?
Yeah. Instagram, Twitter at JMutasarin.
George?
At G Hermosa on Twitter and Instagram.
Guys, don't bother finding me at all on social media. Just go and follow Tough Daria and Tuesday Night, and this goes for you guys yes, as well. Download that Tough Enough app. Vote for our girl, Daria Baronato. Hashtag Jersey Devil.
Jersey takeover. Devil takeover. You made it up.
That was so No, that was Daria's. That was mine. Almost had that. Guys, we will talk to you next week.
Nope. Well, yeah. Yeah.
I told you so.
Oh, yeah. 2 weeks we're not here.
Cue it.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
James Mutasri.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.